Good morning, friends. Today we are in conversation with Dr. G.D. Ravindran, who is Professor of Medicine at St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences and a stalwart in the field of HIV prevention, treatment and care. He is also co-chair of the 11th National Conference of AIDS Society of India, being currently held in Bengaluru. Dr. India ranks third by way of numbers of people living with HIV in the world. Can you share with us what has been the progress on the management of the disease during the last few years?
When you look at the numbers, we are the third highest. But when you look at the population statistics, we are just 0.2% of the Indian population, which is HIV positive. Now, when we look at what has happened in the last 4 or 5 years, there has been tremendous change in the management of patients with HIV. To start with, we have newer knowledge that we start every patient on antiretroviral therapy. Before 2015, before these studies, two important studies came about called the START study and Temprano study, which showed that if you start the patient earlier with HIV medication, they live longer and they have a better quality of life and they suffer less from comorbid conditions that come with HIV infection. Before the advent of 2012 or 2015, before that, what used to happen is we used to wait for this measurement called CD4 count. And if the CD4 count came less than 500, we would start them on treatment. If the CD4 count is less than 200, then it would have been called as AIDS or a syndrome. So when the CD4 fell under for less than 500, we used to start them on antiretroviral therapy. But the START study showed that if you start the patients earlier on treatment, they live better. So one thing is definite, that HIV medication, antiretroviral medication, bring down mortality, morbidity of the patients. The second important study which came about somewhere in 2012 was known as HPT1052 study. And the important things of this study was it showed that HIV anti putting the patients on antiretroviral therapy reduces the transmission of HIV infection. In this study, which was elegantly done, they took zero discordant couples. That means one of them was positive. Either the man or the woman was positive. The other person was negative. They counseled them about safe sex, prevention, all this thing was told. And what they did was they divided them into two groups. In one group, they started antiretroviral therapy as soon as they were diagnosed as HIV positive. The second group, they started antiretroviral therapy after they fulfilled the national criteria. At that time when the study was being done, in India also we had centers. Our center was starting off ART medication was when the CD4 count was less than 350. So and at the end of the study, which was for 5 years, they discovered there are only 29 infections. And out of these 29 infections, all the infections occurred in patients who had started ART medications later. And it is postulated it prevents the transmission of infection by 96%, which is a very, very good preventive strategy. Since then, our focus has changed from using condom promotion to test and treat everyone. And the third thing that has happened is the WHO has called for 90-90-90. That is 90% of HIV positive patients should be detected. Of those 90%, 90% should be started on treatment. And of those 90%, treatment should have shown that their virus is totally suppressed. In fact, what this works out when you totally this thing is, out of 100 patients, 72% patients should not have any virus in the blood. So this is 90-90, and the government of India has agreed to follow this principle, and we are trying our best to achieve this principle by trying to get more number of testings to be done and more intensive counseling and giving of medications to these patients. This is an important thing from an epidemiological point of view, where antiretroviral drugs are being used and the government is scaling up. It is not only drugs that are necessary for treatment. We also need to know how the person is behaving with treatment. Since it does not have any clinical signs Like, for example, there are no signs which will say there is improvement, the virus has disappeared. We need to measure the endpoints of treatment. Previously, we used to use CD4 counts. And if the CD4 count would rise after starting antiretroviral therapy, and after about 2 to 3 years, it would plateau off. Then if the drugs did not work, the CD4 cell would come down. But today, we know that when the before the CD4 cells drop in the blood, the virus in the blood increases. So now we are talking about using viral load as a major measure for monitoring therapy. So what we have done is the government of India has already launched that. 640 machines have been procured. They would measure the viral load, and at the end of 6 months of treatment, the virus has to completely disappear from the blood. Blood should be without any virus. And if there is virus present, that means the drug is not acting. So we discover that the person is not active with the drug, and we start taking the treatment as early as possible, change the treatment as early as possible. And apart from this, viral load measurements have come about, and they have made a change in how we are going to manage. The other thing that has happened with this type of change in the viral way of monitoring, the drug therapy has become very simple. There are drugs which have become less toxic, and they can be combined and used. And India has been a pioneer in producing pills, which is a single pill which combines three other drugs to make a single pill. To be effective, you need to give minimum of three drugs for a patient. Now, I already said that at the end of 6 months, the virus disappears from the blood. The question is, if the virus disappears from the blood, why should we treat the patient longer? Because the virus hides in the body. There are areas like in the lymph nodes where the virus will take at least 2 years to disappear once we start the treatment. And there are certain areas called sanctuary sites where the virus goes and hides and it will not divide. So that is usually in the intestines and in the brain. Now we have drugs which are under pipeline which can stimulate this virus to come out and get destroyed. And once this happens, now as per the mathematical modeling, if you do not stimulate the virus to come out, you need therapy at least for 25 years. And therefore, we talk about treatment for life. Once we have these drugs and start using these drugs, maybe the therapy will be shortened, just like it happened in tuberculosis. We had 3 years treatment, then we had 1.5 years treatment. Now we have 6 months treatment. And I hope by the time I disappear, I will get this drug and it'll be effective, because these drugs in scientific journals show that they're very effective. But whether they'll be able to come into public domain, it'll take another 5 to 6 years. The other question that people ask is, how long does a person with HIV on antiretroviral therapy will live? Till 2017, I had no answer. I would say you will live longer, you will be healthier. But in 2017, there are two studies which came out which showed that if person take antiretroviral therapy and the virus is suppressed, CD4 is more than 350, there is no difference in life expectancy. Like, for example, if you say people born in 1970s should live up to age of 50% of them will live up to age of 66. That is life expectancy. So 50% of the HIV positive patients who are born in 70s will live up to age of 66. Now, with this prolongation, what we have is a new set of problems which has HIV physicians we deal with. We have elderly patients who come with HIV infections and who need to be treated. And there, because they are elderly, they have other problems. They may have diabetes, they may have hypertension, they may have falls which are less. So our treatment must take into these conditions, because drugs that are used for treatment also can produce side effects which will worsen those conditions which elderly patients have. One of the good things that we have is with the mother-to-child transmission, the treatment has become so effective that over a period of time, we hope that pediatric HIV infection, mother-to-child transmission will completely disappear. Already with the testing of blood for HIV, we have reduced the transmission, which was about 8% in 2000, to less than 1% now. Even that can be eliminated. So that leaves us the major chunk, which is the sexual transmission of HIV infection. And with the treatment that we have, I'm sure in by 2030, which is the date that we have agreed upon, that we will reduce this epidemic to a very, very low levels. Has so much so people talk of eradicating this infection from the face of the world. Not only we have had taken medical thing that has taken better work, we also have taken care of social problems. Like our country, we have the HIV bill, which was passed in 2017, and it has been gazetted now in 2018, and that protects the rights of the HIV infected persons. You cannot test without having consent. You have to maintain confidentiality. And much more important is, it makes us HIV positive patients eligible for insurance. This recent Supreme Court order abolishing Article 377, which criminalized the homosexuality, I mean, the men having sex with men, is decriminalizes it so that more patients are coming out in open to about the sexuality and gender so that better prevention methods can be taking place. Not only that, the government of India has also provided free transport in the concessional railways for patients so that they can live. And as far as possible, they do not discriminate on employment because of the laws are there, the court rulings are there that protect persons. And I hope as the time goes on, when more science comes in, we will have a hope for a vaccine. Already trials are there which have started on vaccines, and recently I read that it is very it is still in the trial phase and it produces good immunogenicity. Maybe in another 10 years time we will have a vaccine that can prevent HIV infection. We have also had tremendous progress in development of new drugs. In the beginning, we had only two classes of drugs. Then we had a third class of drug, which is called as protease inhibitors, which changed the face of HIV infection. Then we have now, we have about nine classes of drugs which have been there. 2018, we had a monoclonal antibody, which is protective against the virus as it develops. So we have a lot of drugs which are likely to come into for treatment of HIV infection. But there are also problems, because with HIV infection, we also have TB. And TB and HIV go hand in hand. So treatment of TB is more important for the community than treatment of HIV infection. So TB treatment takes precedence. And once the patient person is started on treatment, you can start them on TB medication. The other problem, especially in our country in the Northeast, is the presence of hepatitis C virus. And today we have very effective drug that reduces, which can be given for 12 weeks, which totally eliminates hepatitis C virus. Though it is costly, it is worth paying for it and getting the treatment. The third problem that we have is hepatitis B virus, which again is a problem that needs vaccination and protection. Today, as we look at HIV positive patients 20 years ago and now, many of our patients suffer from diseases which come with aging, and much more important is they suffer from cancers. And many of our HIV positive patients today die of cancers than of infections that we saw in the past. I'm sure there is a lot of hope in treatment and working for HIV positive patients, as one of the diseases in my lifetime I hope will be eradicated.
Thank you very much. You've given such a clear explanation and a clear picture of the status of the disease and where India is. Can you say something about the present challenges which we are facing? And because to achieve the 1990 goals, we need to put a stop to new infections, which the curve is not bending that much as it should be. So in the context of our country, what do we need to focus upon?
What we need to focus upon is to spend more money in treatment and in diagnosis. Today, we need to change our paradigm shift, should be there in our way we check for HIV infected patients. Previously, we thought only if the person has got an infection, if he feels that there is a risk of infection, he would go and test for testing. This was known as voluntary counseling and testing. That has changed to provider-initiated testing. Like, for example, I see a patient who has got tuberculosis. Then I will tell the patient that I need to check you for HIV infection, counsel the patient, and do the testing. So this type of provider-initiated testing will become more relevant, and we will be able to diagnose more patients that way. The second thing that has happened is we used to have a system which is called as where, you know, I ask the permission from the patient saying, I'm going to do a test for HIV, please permit me. Okay. And if the person says no, I would not test. Okay. That has changed into what is known as opt-out technique. That is, I tell the patient, I'm going to test your blood for HIV. If you have any objections, please let me know, then I will not test. And this strategy has been shown, especially in Africa and in the United States, to increase the number of people undergoing testing. And this is the second thing that has come into test. And a third problem that people always say, now, why don't we always keep testing patients? It is not worthwhile because it does not be cost effective to test every person. It is necessary to take a proper history, identify, and if necessary, only then test. So we would get. Now, once you test the patient, then you have to initiate them on ART treatment. Previously, we have to wait for viral load testing, CD4 testing. And the present thing is, the minute a person has found positive, we start treatment. And there have been two ways of doing that. One is, on the day you diagnose a person as having HIV, you start treatment. The second one is, you counsel him for some time and then start as early as possible, usually within a week to 10 days. So these strategies will try to make people take, because if you give time for the patients, they may take, when they are in the process of getting in terms with the disease, they are already taking antiretroviral medication, thereby becoming less infective to others, as well as protecting their health. So this is the second thing. And third thing that has happened, which we are doing, is there is a linkages that have started coming up. Like, for example, previously a person would go to the ART center, and if they felt that he had TB, he would go to the TB center. And the TB center, he would go for treatment. And usually the TB centers may not be near the ART centers. So there will be huge loss of time and follow-up problems. Or the other thing is, patient would go to the TB center, and the TB center would tell them, please go to the ART center, you may be having HIV, and the patient may go or not go. Now what has happened is, there is convergence. So in the TB center itself, the patient is tested for HIV. And if he is found HIV, treatment is initiated. Similarly, when you look at the person who is going to the ART center, his sputum will be examined and found positive, he'll be started on TB. So there is a convergence of the two programs. So in long run, it will help patients to live and better survive the infection. The third thing that is, fourth thing that is happening now is, since this is becoming integrated, which again is good one way, in another way it is bad, because we do not have dedicated counselors who will sit with patients and help them to adhere. And we need to improve their adherence. Today, we are having most of our drugs that we give, have become, three drugs have combined and made it into a single pill, so the adherence becomes easy. We have our electronic media where the centers have started using, sending up WhatsApp messages, reminders, so that people will, SMSs, so that people will remind that they will take the drug like this. And lastly, the most important thing that has happened is, cost of therapy has come down, even in open market. So most of the people can afford. The prices have come down. Where depending on the regimen, it can vary anywhere between 2,000 to 4,000 rupees a month. So in these ways, I'm sure we will be able to bring down HIV infection.
Thank you very much. Friends, you were listening to Dr. G.D. Ravindran, who is Professor of Medicine in St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences, Bengaluru. Thank you very much.